not too far from here. I'll be going there later today. But I really haven't come back since I was like five. I came back once and I was thinking about Grinnell College and I ended up in Counselor. So it's awesome to be back in my birth state. I'm really excited to be here. Thank you guys for having me. This is a very, very, very powerful crowd. Sometimes I don't know if folks realize how powerful they are, you know? I was born here in Iowa, but I was raised in another part of the world called Zimbabwe. And for those of you who don't know, that's Southern Africa, right next to South Africa, just a little north of South Africa. I was raised in the 80s and the 90s. I am that old. And, you know, apartheid was going on next door, so I couldn't step into that country. And a lot of things were going on where I was growing up, too. Issues of development, HIV/AIDS, hitting that part of the world very hard. A lot of real big issues. But I always had this connection still to the fact that I was born here, and I learned a lot about America there. And it was actually a source of pride for me that I was from here, too. I remember studying Martin Luther King in my Zimbabwean high school really enjoying what I was learning about what America has accomplished. And actually learning a lot also about, like, what is that?
Bells.
Cool bells. Oh, that's not very smart. You know, even then, I was aware. I enjoyed history. I enjoyed learning about this country. This country has a massive impact on the rest of the world. And even though I was growing up in this other part of the world, I knew everything that was happening here. And so did my classmates, so did my parents, my teachers, our friends, our community. Everybody knew everything that was happening in America. From your elections, to your celebrity tribes, to your music, to your movies, which I also considered mine, because I was American born. We knew everything. So when I say you are a powerful group of people, I say that because everything that happens in America is watched and experienced and affecting the rest of the world. And so when you are the inheritors of this country, you're inheriting the most powerful nation. Its effect, its culture, its voice, what it's accomplished, what it does, what it doesn't do, is deeply experienced by the rest of the world. So you guys are very powerful people. Because some of you can vote. How many of you can vote? That's a good number. That's a powerful, powerful thing that you can do. You can actually affect the most powerful country in the world through walking into a room and expressing your decision. It's a very powerful thing. And there are parts of the world, some parts near where I was growing up, where voting is not even an option. Having a choice isn't an option. And even here, for a lot of folks, starting from the War of Independence, through the suffragettes, through the March on Selma, it wasn't always an option. So it's such an important thing. The thing I get, you know, sometimes I'm at work and I'm dealing with talking to people in their 20s, you know, for me that's really, really young, so y'all are like infants. And they say to me, you know, I don't know if I'm gonna vote. And I'm like, wow, how would you just toss away your power like that? How would you not enact that level of power and affect the world that you're inheriting? Because what's gonna happen in 28 days is directly affecting you guys. So I don't quite know why you wouldn't want to, right? Right? Do you know people who just say they don't want to? You gotta talk to them, right? Because it's not okay. Globally, the world looks to us, for us to just sit at home when people fought and died for the right to vote, for the right of those that they would never see. You think of Martin Luther King, what did he say? The day before he was shot, he talked about seeing the promised land, though not making it to the promised land. We're the promised land, right? You're the promised land. This beautiful room of people from all over, of different very, very courageous efforts that were made with you in mind. So please tell me you're going to talk to whoever you know who's trying to not go into that polling station on that day. Or right now, because you can vote right now in Iowa. My first state. You can vote right now. So please make sure we get that message through ourselves and others. We are in a powerful position, and the world is watching. And we affect the world. America is not just about America. America has been the leader in many things for many, many, many generations. And it comes with responsibility. So we affect that. Why am I here? What the heck am I doing here? Well, on TV, those of you who may or may not watch it, I play this character, and she has been called sword-wielding, strong, formidable, smart. Now she's got a bit more heart going on. She's got all these great things going on, and it's really fun to play her. So yeah, people call her strong, they call her a bad A, they call her all... But I don't think she has anything on Secretary Hillary Clinton. When I see that type of strength, resilience, power, ability, I'm like, I think that's who I want to run this very, very, very powerful country. So when I looked at the stakes at hand, what we're dealing with, the fact that she just said yesterday, stronger together, which is the slogan of the campaign. She said, it's not a slogan to me. It's a blueprint for our country. I was born in Rimmel, Iowa. I was raised in Zimbabwe. I'm American. So for me, a blueprint for me of diversity and togetherness is all I know. I don't want division. I don't want a wall. I want togetherness. I think there's power in that. I've seen the power in that. I've experienced it in myself. I went to a high school that was all girls, kind of boring that way, but it also was very diverse in Africa. I went to a college not far away from here, McAllister College in Minnesota. Very diverse. Different voices, different thoughts, different ideas. Sometimes we didn't agree, but we were powerful together. I learned things. Even when I wasn't sure if I agreed with somebody, I learned some things. I wanted to know about other things. I wanted to learn more tolerance, more connection. I want a leader who talks and thinks about tearing walls down, not a guy who talks and thinks about building one up. I want to move forward. And moving forward to me means we connect more, not less. So to me, I was with a colleague the other day, I said, I'm gonna go out on the trail a little bit. They're like, really? And I said, yeah, and I'll tell you why, very simply. I have to wake up the day after this election and know I did all I could. I have to be able to live with myself and know whatever the outcome, I did what I could. And I'm in this room today, and I'm going to other rooms over the next several weeks because I'm trying to do all I can. And I just want to encourage everybody. I know some of you are volunteers already, which is awesome. Volunteering is the most powerful, most rewarding thing you can do. Keep doing that. Keep doing that. Give back. Contribute. It's your land. This is your land. This is your land. So take it and be sure that you have a vision for where you want it to go and contribute that way. So I'm here for that reason. I think Secretary Clinton is deeply powerful, deeply resilient, deeply smart, deeply prepared. And also for me, the thing that really defines choice, and what I love about a democracy is you can make your choice, make it, but make it, right? So for me, I have to find that thing in my soul that connects with the soul of a candidate. understand something in their soul. I have to see their soul. And when I looked at the history of Secretary Clinton's life, what was driving her, there was an interesting documentary about her also this weekend on CNN. And from the time she was your age, she was connecting with issues. She was caring about things bigger than herself. Her dad took her to listen to Martin Luther King speak, and she was hooked. She knew she wanted to do more for society. She went and worked and advocated for children and women right out of Yale Law School. Well, let me tell you something. Right out of Yale Law School, you can do a lot of things, okay? And make a lot of money. That wasn't her choice. Her choice was to advocate for young women and children. And that's really resonated throughout her entire time in office or in public life. Her work that she did once again when she was first lady, getting 9 million kids covered for medical treatment, for medical insurance, showed her heart to me, showed her soul to me. Another thing very important to me, my plays are about this, African women. We don't hear a lot about African women, but I'm one, and they exist, and I'd like to hear their voices more in the world. And she cares about global women's issues. In 1995, as the First Lady, she was the first person on that level to speak out in Beijing and say, women's rights are global rights, and global are human rights, and human rights are women's rights. That's important, because to me, my play was just on Broadway, and it was about girls and women in war. And I went to Liberia, which was a war zone, and girls just like you and you and you and you, they couldn't go to school because there was a war going on. They got snatched from their homes. And this is gonna sound ugly, but it's real and it's the world. They were systemically raped, held by warlords as war booty. They didn't have the choice to say, I want to do this, or maybe I'll volunteer, or maybe I'll vote, or maybe I won't. They didn't have choices taken from them. And the power that a first lady or a citizen of the United States has to say, we need to speak up for those people who can't speak for themselves, is a very significant power. Secretary Clinton started to give voice to those issues on the level she was at. She gives awards every year to women who have been courageous in countries where they got tortured for what they spoke about, where they were getting attacked for what they were saying. To me, that's important stuff. We're still in a country and a world where there's a gender gap. That's just the reality. A girl and a boy go get the same job, same qualifications, he's gonna get paid more. That's the reality right now. We still have issues to deal with in this society. Sexual assault is a massive issue across the globe. Our language, how we speak about women and girls, affects how we think about ourselves and how we are thought about and how we are treated. Don't ever tell me words don't matter. So my question is, who do we want to helm this country? Because it is a very important helm. To me, there is a fit candidate and an unfit candidate. To me, there is someone I think does not have the temperament to handle the pressures of this office. I love to see what I saw on Sunday in the sense that I saw a very composed woman dealing with a lot of bile and lies coming at her 1,000 miles an hour, but I saw someone who retained composure. As the leader of this country, you need composure. You need a cool head. You need to know how to handle various situations just like that. So to me, it was so obvious. But one thing that her opponent said on Sunday that I really, really, really thought was truthful and factual was when he said, Secretary Clinton is strong, she's a fighter, and she never, ever gives up. I like that. A woman almost 70 years old, God knows what she went through, that you will never have to go through. You will never have to go through. You will never have to. the next generation. I just want a leader who does that, right? So for me, the choice is clear. But I'm very excited to be around you guys. I think it's so exciting to be around youth because you actually have the way forward in your hearts. You hold the next vision. It's not me, it's not folks up there, it's actually the youth who are holding the thing that will get us through the next century. So I'm really excited to get to know you guys. I'm not telling you who died. Someone will. There you go. You don't want to know. Listen, 2 weeks ago. Less than 2 weeks. You'll find out. I'm really excited to be here. So anything you all want to talk about or ask, John is also here. He's an expert, much more than myself. Bear that in mind. And if I can't answer it, I will pass it over to him. Go ahead, young man.
It's not really a question, but it's a statement. You look different. Just saying.
I hear that all the time. I'm not in apocalypse right now. I've got eyeshadow on. Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Yes. Ones that are just really, really old. They are consistently decomposing. That is happening. But they just never die unless their brains are taken out, right? So that's the science behind that. Very factual. Go look it up.
Will the population of zombies ever die down?
Say that again?
Will the population of zombies ever die down?
I imagine so with time. You know, because they become more and more decrepit, but I mean, more people die, and if everyone has the virus, then they kind of get replenished, so maybe not, until they find the cure, you know? Yes? I guess for now I'd have to say Rick and Carl.
About last question, okay? One more question.
Is it zombie related? Can you have a nod zombie really?
Over there.
Yes.
How do you get more involved?
Do you want to get more involved? That's awesome. John?
So there are local offices all over. If you go to hillaryclinton.com/volunteer, you can put in your zip code and find your nearest office to get involved. Someone will give you a call and you can either knock doors, make phone calls, or do anything like that to help make that movement in November.
When I was 2008, I wanted to get involved, and it was tricky. I was like, how do you do this? But it's so true. There are systems in place that really help people help, you know? And I was once standing on the streets in New York with my flyers, and I was on the phone bank calling people, and it's really rewarding, and you make a lot of new friends. And it's a camaraderie. It's a very strong camaraderie because you're doing what your heart knows you should do. And following your heart, to me, it's what led me to be able to stand in front of you today. Like, you know, God knows I was being asked to do other careers.
Where are some of the other places you're going around Iowa over the next few? Where are some of the other places you're going around Iowa over the next few weeks?
Well, I'm going to Ames. I'm going to the University of Iowa, which is exciting. That's, I spent a lot of time in Ames when I was a kid, so I'm kind of excited to go back there. I'm going to Grinnell, to the city of my birth, and that's today as well. And then I think tomorrow, I think those are the two other places I'm going today. And then tomorrow I head out to Wisconsin, so I'm not, you know, I'm doing these three cities and then I'm heading into another part of the Midwest. But it's really exciting to be back in the Midwest.
Folks, can we give our guests a round of applause?